Before the 20th century, there really was no concept of a Thai nation or Thai nationalism or anything like that. It's a 20th century thing, as it is in so many other countries. And even to this day, there are those in Thailand who resist the sort of state-sponsored Thai-ness that is taught in schools, as opposed to un-Thai-ness. These resistors seek to preserve their own identities at their own risk. So who are the Thai? What does it mean to be Thai? Where do these people come from? Where do the Thai people come from? Now, this is a controversial question, the question of Thai origins. Controversial question. And unfortunately for us non-specialists, those who study the issue often disagree with one another. But we're going to try to unravel it today. Well, whatever the specific homeland, such as it might have been, of the Thai-speaking peoples, we're pretty confident that the ancestors of many of those from Thailand today lived south of the Yangtze River in what is today southern China. This would be several thousand years ago. And that there they lived until population pressure from the north began to push them out. See, around the 200s BC, we have the first big empires arising in China. First, the short-lived but trend-setting Qin Empire, and then, of course, the 400-year Han Empire. This is the great empire that in the east mirrored sort of the Roman Empire in the west, so the Han Empire. And these guys extended south much further than any of their predecessors. And it wasn't just Han armies that conquered south, Qin and Han armies, but it was also Han migrants who moved south. So maybe this population pressure contributed to pushing out some of these Thai-speaking peoples who moved into Southeast Asia. And about 1,000 years later, we see the pattern sort of repeating. We're talking the 700s and the 800s AD, coinciding with the rise of yet another great Chinese empire, the Tang. With the rise of the Tang Empire, we see more migration from Thai-speaking peoples out of what will become southern China, what is southern China at that point, into Southeast Asia. And in Southeast Asia, these migrants come across or come in contact with a world that is perhaps less influenced by China and the Sinocentric world than by India, the Indocentric world. Here they come across kingdoms and polities whose religious and political systems are much more Indian, or at least selectively Indian. The elites of these kingdoms selectively imitate political, cultural, architectural patterns from India, even writing from India, and many other aspects of their culture. This elite culture are Indian, much more Indian than Chinese. Well, eventually a significant number of these Thai-speaking peoples migrated all the way to the Chao Phraya River Basin. They started up in the hills, and then fringes of the hills, and then finally down into the valley itself. Hot, humid, jungly, foresty valley. The Chao Phraya. This is, by the way, this is the great river that runs through the middle of Bangkok today. So they made it into this river valley, and here the great powers were, well, there were the Mon people. Of course, they'd been here for centuries, Theravada Buddhists, known in their village states and city states and little polities collectively as Dvaravati, the Dvaravati kingdom sometimes it's called. And the other great power, the Khmer, the principal ancestors of the Cambodians today. The Khmer Empire, this was a Hindu empire. And also quite a bit of Mahayana Buddhist influence being projected by the Khmer. But these were the two other great populations, the Khmer and the Mon, in this Chao Phraya River Valley when these Thai-speaking peoples arrived. And when they arrived, they were kind of the barbaric newcomers. These other guys, particularly the Khmer, would recruit among the Thai. The Thai were known as fierce warriors. Maybe this has something to do with some martial skill fighting the Chinese or learned from the Chinese in the distant past, who knows? But many of them worked as mercenaries for the Khmer, organized in their little village states or little city-states, small polities, sometimes independent, but usually under the sway of the Khmer Empire. And the 1300s was established the first really great Thai empire, that of Ayutthaya. Now, there'd been other Thai sort of mini-empires and polities before, in particular that of Sukhothai, the Kingdom of Sukhothai, which is considered by many nationalists as the beginning of the national history, if there is such a thing. But nothing like Ayutthaya. Ayutthaya took things to the next level. In its heyday, Ayutthaya was one of the great cities on earth, one of the most cosmopolitan, most prosperous, and most powerful cities on earth. And when early Europeans came here, in particular the Portuguese, they were very impressed And they ranked it right up there with China and India, the empire of Ayutthaya, in terms of power and prestige. Now, you may notice that Ayutthaya sounds a lot like Ayodhya, the great Indian Hindu city, site of the legendary, you know, King Ram and his Ramraj. Ramraj, a golden age of rule and prosperity and power. Well, clearly, the rulers of Ayutthaya had named their city in order to boost their legitimacy, and in part in order to claim that they were overseeing a Ramraj, a golden age of power and prosperity. Okay, they were imitating, in fact, the Hinduism of the great empire next door, the Khmer Empire, and so Ayutthaya adopted that Hindu framework as well, and very carefully selected the name Ayodhya, or its Thai variant, Ayutthaya. Well, for about 80 years, the Ayutthaya state continued to expand, particularly at the expense of its east-west neighbors, incorporating various Mon peoples, Mon polities, and eating away at the weakened Khmer Empire. In fact, it was Ayutthaya forces that invaded the Khmer capital, Angkor, and took it down, caused it to be abandoned by the Khmer. So this speaks to the power, the military might of Ayutthaya at its zenith. Now, north-south, it was checked a little more, checked in the north by the Burmese, who eventually would control much of what is today northern Thailand, and checked in the south by sort of a Malay golden age going on, centered around Malacca. But a very, very powerful polity, able to carve out an empire much larger than today's France. Very hierarchical society, lots of slavery going on, very prosperous for the elite who controlled the trade routes, not just by sea. And, you know, merchants would arrive, they'd come by sea and then come up the river and trade. Very cosmopolitan, merchants from all over the world. But also there was an overland trade route, a trade route that would allow merchants to not have to go around the Malay Peninsula, which took a long time and was dangerous, a lot of pirates and things, but instead go overland. So this connected, you know, the China-centered world with the India-centered world overland. Very, very lucrative controlling this overland trade route. And all the while, you have peoples from all over, from Persia to China and beyond, Mon, Lao, Khmer, Chinese, various Muslim groups, Indians and others, all mixing together, intermarrying, and forming a genealogical base for today's Thai people, which makes trying to identify a common Thai heritage very muddy. Well, in the 1300s all the way to the late 1500s, this whole region of Southeast Asia was torn apart by war, and the Ayutthaya state was not spared this very, very bloody conflict. All the major players in this region emerged from the war weaker than they'd been before. However, by the 1600s, the old prosperity had returned, had been revived due to Ayutthaya's place as sort of a nexus between east-west trade. Going all the way into the 1700s, Ayutthaya experienced sort of a zenith in terms of power, prestige, the luxury that its elites enjoyed. Unfortunately for the Ayutthaya state and those who benefited from its power, to the north in Burma, a new dynasty, an aggressive, ambitious, expansive dynasty had come to power, invaded Ayutthaya, the city, and took it down. Ayutthaya was subsequently abandoned as political capital. And so that ended this first incarnation of really Thai state, if there is such a thing. A few years later, down the Chao Phraya River, a new capital was founded, that of Bangkok by the Chukri dynasty. This is 1782. And throughout the period of European or aggressive European colonization, talking the late 1700s, throughout the 1800s and into the 20th century, mostly British and French in this region, Thailand was not colonized. The only major Southeast Asian country that was not colonized. Now, why would that be? Well, part of it was because the British and the French saw Thailand or Siam as a buffer state between the two, very important. But also, Thai leaders, the Siamese leadership, became very good at playing the British and the French off of each other. Maybe the most important development during the colonial period is the introduction, though, of ideas, Western ideas. Ideas that are brand new, for the most part, in this region of the world. Ideas like the nation, the concept of the nation, nationalism, sovereignty, the nation state. See, these are new concepts. Fast forward to the 20th century, and it's the Thai state itself, at least that entity posing as the Thai state. First under, you know, absolute monarchs until 1932, and then after that, a series of centralized governments, often led by the military. Anyway, these guys are imposing Thainess, or their criteria, and the narrative connected to those criteria of Thai-ness, what it means to be Thai as opposed to un-Thai. And this stuff is taught in schools critically. And you know, if you resist this or oppose this, you face shunning. You face social and sometimes political and economic repercussions for resisting this state-imposed definition, these state-imposed criteria of Thai-ness. Okay, exceptionalism, state-imposed exceptionalism, this is heady stuff. There's a reason that states cultivate it. But if you're gonna cultivate it, you have to maintain it. And in this, you're often helped by the people. The people themselves will shun those, and otherwise punish those, often, who refuse to toe the line. To say you're Thai today could mean any number of things. It could mean you're a citizen of the state of Thailand. It could mean you're a citizen of the state of Thailand and a Theravada Buddhist, or at least the Thai version of Theravada Buddhism, which includes lots of local, you know, beliefs and traditions with some Hindu accretions thrown in. To say you're Thai could mean you're part of the large Thai subgroup of the even larger Thai ethno-linguistic group found in southern China and northeast India and throughout Southeast Asia. That's what it could mean. At some point in the past, Thai meant human being. At another point, Thai meant free man. One-third of the Thai population at one point may have been slaves, and Thai meant free, free man, free person. Who knows? A lot of different definitions of Thai, and as we've discussed, very, very muddy when it comes down to heritage and trying to trace one single story. Very, very muddy trying to nail down one definition of what it means to be Thai. But perhaps the more important question is, what's so important to the modern state about defining the nation? Why is that so important? And what does that tell us about any national narrative?